So hello everyone. I have the pleasure to introduce you today, Ignacio Trujillo, who is a researcher at the Instituto de Astrofísica de Canarias in Tenerife. So he did his PhD there and then moved to a postdoc in Max Planck Institute of Heidelberg, and then to another postdoc in the University of Notre Dame, and he's now a full researcher at the IAC. And his research is mainly focused on the morphological evolution of massive galaxies. And he's also here for this afternoon's PhD defense of Sébastien Carassou, which will take place here at 3 p.m. if you want to come. But today he's going to talk to us about very low surface brightness galaxies from very deep survey images.
Thank you very much. Can you hear me well? Okay. No?
It's not on?
Yes, it's working. It's okay? Okay. Okay, thanks for the invitation. It's a big pleasure to be here in Paris talking about a world that we have been working in the last, let's say, almost 10 years. And of course, I was wondering whether it's possible to switch off these lights a little bit or. Ah, for the video, okay, no problem. Okay, so then you are going to lose like 3 or 4 magnitudes in super brightness. Okay. Anyway. The point is that, of course, no one works, or very little people works alone, so the work that I'm going to present here is the result of a lot of efforts of many people, including many young students, and I've been so fortunate to work with those because they are really, really good astronomers. So let me start from the beginning, and just to say that over many centuries, many centuries, our only instrument to see the sky was the naked eye, of course. And the naked eye is a wonderful instrument that allows us to see low surface brightness, even it's such a small that it's only 8 millimeters at night, no? And but even with such a small instrument, we were able over many centuries to see low surface brightness features like the light from the Milky Way and also the central part of the closer galaxies like the Andromeda galaxy, so that is visible in a very dark night. So reaching what we will call to in modern notation observation of the order of 16 magnitudes per square second. Of course, everything changes with the invention of the telescope. So we improved by far since the telescope by Galileo. And now, with the modern facilities like the Sloan, which are basically what everybody would be in agreement, which is the standard today in imaging, no? Anytime that we think on a galaxy, it's probably a galaxy observed by the Sloan. With this kind of facilities, we have improved by 4 order of magnitude, and we can see things which are of the order of 26.5 magnitudes per square second. What we don't realize so often is how would be the universe if we, instead of having eyes, were having telescopes in our head. So then the galaxies like the Andromeda 31 or other galaxies or, you know, supernova explosion or so would be huge objects on the sky. So for example, Andromeda would expand by 4 or 5 moons, full moons in the sky. So it would be an absolutely wonderful view of the dark nights if we were able to see at this level with our eyes. However, we know that we can go deeper than this, and we know this since at least 20 years, thanks to the pioneer work by David Malling and others using photographic plates. And here you have how this galaxy would typically look like in the Sloan, and how exposure with 1 meter telescope over 1 hour or so start to observe many more features around the galaxies. So we know that there is a lot of stuff around. So the question then is why we don't have regularly imagings like this for all the sky? And the answer is that it's extremely difficult to reach one order of magnitude deeper than Sloan. The reason is, as you know, there are many difficulties that prevent you to have a very good imaging, which are, for example, the first problem that you have is the sky's brightness, that on Earth typically in the darkest observatories of the order of 22 magnitudes per square second. So you can go to the sky, you can use the space telescope, and then you have 23.5, so you increase by 1.5 to magnitude, but still you have zodiacal light or so. So you have a number of things that are always bright on the sky. No? Then you have also, if you go a little bit down to 26 or even fainter, you see that the light that is coming from the sky, it's you know, making it's touching also the structure of the telescope and producing artificial structures on your CCDs. And then if you go even deeper and you almost reach 30 magnitudes per square second, what you find is that the light, not only from your sources, but also the scatter light connected to the point strength function of your images, is filling everything. And in fact, if you reach 29.5 magnitudes per square second, basically 90% of your CCDs are full with this extra light, that is light scattered from the objects. So there are potential solutions for this. We know this for long. It's just simply you integrate enough, because this is basically noise. Here, either you use telescope with simple optics, or you use clever observing strategies to remove these artifacts. And here, basically, what you would need to do is to have an exquisite characterization of the point spread function of the images to be able to remove that. But even if you do that, then you have another problem, an extra challenge, if you wish, which is the galactic cirrus, that as soon as you go to 28, 29 magnitudes per square second, you basically find those filling the entire image. And this is something that you cannot solve putting a telescope you know, outside the Earth, but you really need to go outside the galaxy, which is still many years from now to happen. No? So, and people normally think that this is a problem connected to the central part of the galaxy, but it's not really the case. So in fact, you can see that there are only few spots that are really relatively clean of this contamination. This is simply because we can have galactic cirrus very nearby to our solar system, and it's occupying a lot of the degrees over us. So depends. It changes a lot. It could be as bright as 23 and as faint as you want. So anyway, so if we were again just following with the analogy of what would look the sky if we were able to reach this depth, 28.5 or so. So this is again the M31 galaxy. And you can see this is the moon to scale, and this is the field around M31. So if we were able to see 100,000 times fainter than with the naked eye, this is how the sky would look like around M31. So you can see it's a completely different arena to what we are used to. So there has been many, many efforts to obtain images like this in the last few years, let's say, including people working here previously, like Pierre Alain Duc, or Chris Mijos, or now with the Dragonfly from Peter Van Dokkum. But I'm going to show you the work that we have been doing, which is a work that we have called the AC Stripe 82 Legacy Project. The Stripe 82, it's a stripe of Sloan. It's an equatorial stripe here. It's the green one showing here. And it's a particularly interesting one because due to the latitude that it has, which is equatorial, it can be spot from both telescopes in the north and in the south. So if you find interesting objects here, it's the best place to look at. The interesting thing of this stripe is that it was repeated 80 times with the Sloan telescope, and originally it was sought to look for things that change with time, like supernovae or so. So it was a way of detecting transients, no? Transient objects. But if you think on that, you can also reduce the data and look for low super brightness features in something that is equivalent to 1 hour in a 2.5 meter telescope, but with the exquisite technique of the drift scan that remove already many of the artifacts. So it's absolutely great to have these to explore. In addition, you will have for free the 5-band of Sloan. So what we did, what I did together with Jürgen Fleury, was to take the raw data and to stack all the data. And of course, this was not the first time that someone tried to make a stacking of the data. In fact, in the past, Anis and Giant independently make a stack of the data, but they were interested for point sources science, okay? So they just simply combine the data and look for sources which were of the order of, point source of the order of 25 magnitudes in our band. So we did that stack, but instead of making the traditional stacking, we were taking into account quite a lot the problems with the sky and to avoid the over-subtraction of features that typically appears when you just simply stack the data and you don't care too much about the sky properties. So in fact, here you can see a comparison between the same field with the two different reductions, the one that are optimized to the text point sources and the one that it's done with non-aggressive sky subtraction. And you can see how this filamentary dash structure is much better seen when you make a reduction caring about loss of brightness. In fact, if you go here and quantify, you can see here this is equivalent to 26 magnitudes per square second. You still have the feature very well detected. However, here you have over-subtracted the sky and also the filamentary structure. So here, then, we have produced this new reduction, and also we have improved with more things the reduction. So we have also removed remaining features that appear because of the scanning technique, and then we have produced a cleaning survey of 300 square degrees in 5 bands, which it's publicly available, and I will give you now the reference to how to access. And it has, you know, typical properties which are okay in terms of resolution of the order of 1 arcsecond. So we include a point spread function, catalog, and the combination also of the GRNI image to get another 0.3 magnitudes deeper, what we have called the ultra-deep R-band imaging. So once you have this, you can start making signs, interesting signs. And for example, I'm going to give you a number of cases of things that we have published with the data. One is, for example, the detection of what it has been called recently ultra-diffuse galaxies. So you probably have heard about these objects that have been recently considered and explored again, although they were discovered many years ago. But now a paper from Peter Van Dokkunen and collaborators in COMA have spotted a number of objects that are quite faint, so centers of brightness in the G-band fainter than 24 magnitudes per square second, and also relative large in size with effective radius of above 1.5 kiloparsec. And in fact, when you look at galaxy clusters, you can identify many of these low sulfur brightness and relative extended galaxies that looks like this. So this is a work that we did this year, detecting galaxies in this cluster. But of course, this kind of galaxy can be also found outside cluster, which is a new addition as well. So this is an example of three groups of galaxies. These are Higson compact groups. And you can find as well sources which are galaxies which are very faint, but as well quite extended. So when you identify this type of galaxies, both in rich regions and intermediate regions, you can try to make a plot of this kind, which is to see what is the number of these low sulfur brightness and extended galaxies as a function of either the velocity dispersion of the structure where they are, so the velocity dispersion of the group, the velocity dispersion of the massive clusters, or the typical mass, the 200 mass, which is a measurement of the mass that is connected with the velocity dispersion, so it's basically the same plot. So let's focus on the one that you can measure directly, which is this one. So you can study whether there is a linear or not relation between the number of ultra-diffuse galaxies and the mass of the dark matter host that contain the galaxies. And in fact, you can see that in the log-log plot, you can see a quite nice really linear relation, implying that in fact, you see more of these objects in rich cluster compared to groups or the field. But because of the linearity here, you can see that there are no more in relative number, more frequent in high density or rich cluster than in groups. So the origin maybe is not in cluster, but outside, and then they fall in. Of course, another thing that you can do when you have such a kind of imaging is to look for objects that were not observed, for example, in Sloan. So this kind of lucky detection, this is a nice example. This is the group of M77. And it turns out that looking at the redshift distribution of the galaxy here, we identify an spectra in Sloan, which is this one, that is located here. And apparently, there was nothing underneath. No? It was just a clump that it was detected there. So we took a look with the Stribe82 data, and it turns out that this spectra was connected to this blob here, and underneath the blob there was an extended low sulfur brightness galaxy, which is this one, UGC-2162. So it was detected previously in deeper surveys. And once you have the deep imaging of the Stribe82, you can explore the properties of these ultra-diffuse galaxies in a lot of detail, because this galaxy is only 12 megaparsec away. We can see all the morphology, the color distribution, just to see whether it's star forming or not, and so forth. In the spectra, we were able to detect some emission lines, H alpha, H gamma, that allow us to make an estimation of the star formation rate. And we were lucky as well, because the galaxy had a detection in H1, and it turns out that we could estimate from there, from the width of the H1 line, the mass in gas and compare with the mass in stars. So you can see that this kind of galaxy has 10 times more mass in gas than in stars. And from the width, we can also estimate the dynamics, and it turns out that it was an object of 5 × 10⁹ solar masses, dynamically inside 5 kiloparsecs, extended to what you would expect from the dark matter, would be equivalent to have an object within a halo slightly less than 10⁻¹. So it was somehow like a normal dwarf galaxy, rich with a huge quantity of gas, but a little bit more extended than the usual dwarf that you can find. Another interesting exercise that you can do with this is that, okay, I measured this sulfur brightness in the three bands, G, R, and I. This is the sulfur brightness profile. And because the galaxy is relatively active today, what would happen if this galaxy just simply stopped forming stars? How would they move in terms of low sulfur brightness? Well, if you just make this evolve, I mean, if you just take the colors that you measure and you make them evolve according to a quench of the galaxy, then the sulfur brightness would decrease by an order of 2 magnitudes, and also the colors will change slightly to getting redder, of course. So in principle, although we are able to detect these objects relatively easily with Stribe82, the prediction is that the red side, or the evolution with time of this kind of galaxy, will produce even darker galaxies, okay, with sulfur brightness below 26, and in principle, with time, you would expect to find if many even lower sulfur brightness galaxies, but red ones. Okay, only there is a few objects like this already found, a few of them in Virgo by Chris Miho's work. So, but in principle, many of these objects are waiting to be discovered. In addition to the detection of ultra-diffuse galaxies, of course, with the because the Stribe82 is so large, you can making all different kind of science, not only low sulfur brightness galaxy, but for example, if you are interested on the emission of galactic cirrus, you can see the difference in quality of the Sloan to Stribe82, so you can see a field of cirrus, you can start exploring the colors, you can start exploring the densities, and the structure, whether it's fractal or not, so many things to do. You can also take your favorite galaxies in the Stribe82 and see whether something new appears when you go 2 magnitudes deeper than Sloan. For example, this is a very nice galaxy where it's classified as a regular elliptical, but once you go 2 magnitudes deeper, it appears a blue feature around that resembles very nicely a spiral, so it's a kind of chameleonic galaxy that changes depending on how deep you go. Then you can explore merging and the tidal features connected to the merging up to distance of 100 kiloparsecs. You can explore the Sick disk. You can also start making accounting of features around galaxies. This is the Darth Vader galaxy because the central part of the galaxy resembles one of these fighters of the Star Wars. Okay, and then you can see when you go 2 magnitudes deeper, you can start exploring the appearance of filaments like that and to start making statistics with, let's say, a few hundred galaxies. You can also explore the intracluster light. For example, this is the IC-1101. This is the galaxy supposed to be the largest galaxy in the universe. So from here to here is a megaparsec. So a Milky Way is something like this compared to the galaxy, so it's a huge monster. So the cluster that we have of this kind, we're gonna start exploring all this light around, the intracluster light, and start to characterize this much better than with previous data. So if you are interested in this kind of science or another science that you can have in your mind if you need deep data, I encourage you to go to this webpage where we have made all the survey publicly available. It's extremely easy to use. You just go here, you just click data, just put the coordinates of your favorite field in the Stripe82, and then you get everything reduced to you in all the bands, with the rectification of the sky, with weights, with PSF, catalogs. So anything that you are interested to do, you can do it there. And now we are working, we are still quite active working on this Stripe82 data, and we are doing an extra step that I think is quite new in terms of deep surveys, and I haven't seen anything published similar like that, but our plan is the following. So once we have the data reduced, the next step is to characterize very well the PSF. So we create extended PSF, we create scatterlight models of the images, so we take all the bright PSF, so we put the models here, and we subtract it from the data, so two clean from the scatterlight, and you can see now that things that were difficult to see because of the scatterlight now appears more clearly, like this very nice massive cluster here. So we plan to make all this public as well, which I think is a new addition because we remove all this extra light from the bright sources around. So stay tuned for this. So this is more or less the state of the art in terms of the what people is producing in terms of deep images, which is of the 28.5, 29 magnitudes per square second. So the question is if we can go even deeper. So it's possible to go 10 times deeper and, you know, cross the barrier of 30 magnitudes per square second, or it's almost impossible. Well, the first question is why do we need to go beyond 30 magnitudes per square second? And the reason is because many interesting cosmological problems are linked to go as deep as that. So, for example, if you want to study the envelopes or the stellar halos around galaxies like the Milky Way, you really need to cross the barrier of 30 magnitudes per square second to see this in the full glory, all the streams, all the matter that is there. So if you want to make a real quantitative characterization of these cosmological predictions, you really need to go such deep. For example, this is from a simulation by Cooper, 2010, of the stellar halo of Milky Way-like galaxies, and you can see that here is the super brightness of the light in the B-band, and you can see that with traditional images up to 25, 26 magnitudes per square second, you just see this tiny blob here, which is the typical size of that you are used to, the Milky Way, no? This is in kiloparsecs, okay? But if you cross 30, or even if you reach 31 or so, you can see how the galaxies extend by a factor of 3 or 4. So they would be huge objects. In fact, coming back again to the analogy, how they would look like if you were looking by this object at the darkest night, so you can see here how the Andromeda galaxy would be with the streams and with the stellar halos around. So see, this is the moon, or the size of the moon. So it would be an absolutely impressive view on the sky of many dozens of square degrees. So this is how the sky would look like if we were able to reach 31.5 magnitudes per square second, which would be equivalent to reach one times deeper than the naked eye in terms of super brightness. In addition to the study of the stellar halo, we would of course be able to explore in galaxies that are not the Milky Way or M31, the problem of the missing satellites. Do you know that this is a classical problem on cosmology, which is that the number of halos, the number of satellite halos is much, much more larger than the ones that you can see in M31 or the Milky Way. Or, of course, this has been explored in these two nearby galaxies using star counts, but the question is our galaxy and M31 particularly special for any reason? It would be really nice to extend this kind of studies to other galaxies beyond our local group and to see whether this problem of the cosmology is something connected somehow to our galaxies, is something connected to feedback, is something connected to the dark matter model. So, worth looking at this in other galaxies. So that's the reason why also to push our data much deeper. And of course, if you want to study the assembly of big structure like the galaxy clusters, so this is the same cluster. It's a simulation of the assembly of a cluster in redshift 2 to now. So if you want to study the intracluster light, you would really like to see how this intracluster light is changing with time. This is redshift 2, this is today. So you would really like to move to redshift 0.5, redshift 1, to see whether this amount of light, which is connected to the assembly of the cluster, is changing with time or not. Because of the cosmological dimming, you really would like to have very deep data just to see whether you are able to detect such features. Well, so let me then present the pilot program that we have conducted at the AEC. So what we have done is to use the GTC telescope, and you can see, of course, if you fix, so the advantage of big telescope, normally they have a small field of view, but if you just concentrate on such a field of view, of course, the amount of light that you can collect is huge. So 1 hour of a 10-meter telescope would be equivalent to 600 hours of a 40-centimeter, like the Dragonfly, or 100 hours in a 1-meter telescope. No? So you really go very fast for a tiny portion of the sky. You really would like to have a much larger field of view, and this would come available with the synoptic telescope in a few years. But of course, with the 10-meter telescope, you can allow yourself to do in relative few hours another type of exercise. Let's see how deep imaging looks like. So what we did was to do such an exercise, but as I said before, if you go extremely deep, if you try to cross the 30 magnitudes per square second barrier, you have many, many problems connected not only to the sky, but also to the structure of the telescope, the dome, so it's quite complicated. So what we tried was to produce a new different strategy to typically deep surveys, which normally just simply make a dithering pattern around a galaxy. So what we did was to add another degree of freedom on the imaging, which is rotations. So just to explain you very easily what we do is we start here, we point the camera, this is the Osiris camera, around this galaxy, okay, and we make this dithering pattern. We change then later on the position angle of the camera, we rotate by 120 degrees, and we repeat the dithering pattern. We rotate the camera another 120 degrees, and again. We start again the same dithering pattern, but with a slight rotation of 10 degrees, and we continue making such a exercise, okay? So in the end, we have like 8 hours on the source with 270 different images with no single pixel observing the same location on the sky. Then what you can do, it's similar to what people does in the near infrared, you can make your flat directly from the science data, okay? And you have a super flat that is quite good to remove all kind of artifacts. So we did this pilot project in these two galaxies, as I said. One is the UGC 180. It's quite far away, 150 megaparsec. So it's like M31. It's with a high rotational velocity, bright absolute magnitude. But it's relative red, so it's quite red for the standard, so it's relative quiet galaxy. And then we did the same exercise, but now including, instead of only one band, we include G and R, just to have a color. And this galaxy is slightly, it's like 1/4 of the mass of the Milky Way, it's a rotational velocity 125 kilometers a second. So if the predictions from the dark matter model, the cosmology, of that any time that you go beyond 30, you should detect stellar halos around the galaxies. If right, then we should see them. And this is, in fact, what we see. So for these two galaxies, this is a galaxy, galactic cirrus emission, so forget about this, but look, concentrate on this region, so you can see a filamentary structure and a roundish stellar halo around here. And for this galaxy, you see some filaments as well here, and maybe also another one here, okay? So, in fact, we see a big number of structures in galaxies that we are not having anything around, in principle, with the Sloan data. But I want you to see the details. So this is galaxy, this is a color image of the NGC 493, and this is a zoom to some regions of the around the galaxies. And I want you to take a look to how the huge number of sources that appear on the data. So, in fact, this level of crowding, so you basically have another point source every 2-3 arcseconds, it's quite close to the confusion limit, so which makes you to wonder what is the really sky when you go so deep. This is reaching 31.5 magnitudes per square second, but if we were able to go slightly deeper, maybe 32, 32.5, what would be the sky? at least in the optical, it seems that if you go to 32 or 33, even including the use of a space telescope, maybe we start finding confusion. So every spot on the sky would have a source underneath. So what would be the meaning of the sky is something to consider then. So anytime that I reach here, people start to get a little bit nervous because they say, okay, you claim that you have gone beyond 30, but how can you prove that what you are observing are not artifacts? Okay, there's two ways that I think that you can do it. One is comparing with other kind of data, and the other one is comparing, for example, the images that you get in one band versus the other one, or versus the other band. If you see the same feature or similar feature, it seems that you are going really, really deep. So this is the first exercise, comparing exactly the same galaxy with different telescopes. So the only thing that is common here is the internal color image, just to put a beautiful data. But here is how the galaxy looks like in the Sloan, how the galaxy looks like in the Strive 82, how the same galaxy looks like with 50 hours of a 1 meter telescope, and this is how the galaxy looks with 6 hours in the 10 meter telescope, the GTC. So you can see that you really need to approach the 30 magnitudes per square second to start observing the filamentary structure or the stellar halo around the galaxy. So these are completely independent data set, different 9 different telescopes, and you see that the features appears to be quite real. Just to show you an example of the depth of the data, this thing that is quite easily detected here is a superbrightness feature fainter than 29 magnitudes per square second. So if we compare the same galaxy but with different filters, this is 5 hours in the G band, this is 6 hours in the R band, look at this. This filamentary structure is very, very easily seen in the two different filters. However, this feature here is not. This is much more conspicuous in the R band than in the G band. But this is a filament or a galaxy cluster of redshift 0.6. So when you go to redshift 0.6, the emission of the intracluster light in the G band, it's quite in the blue, so you don't expect to see it. However, if you move to R band, you start to see it in the visible bands, and that's why the cluster looks much, much nicer. So I hope I have convinced you that we can go so deep, and now that we can go so deep, we can start making quantitative statement about the light outside the galaxies. And this is a comparison of the previous galaxy, the UGC 180, and this is how the profile in the Sloan looks like, and this is how the profile in the GTC deep data looks like. So this is in arcsecond, this is in kiloparsecs, just to have you an idea of how deep we go. This is the superbrightness in the R band in magnitudes per square second. So this is the bulge. This is the traditional disk of the galaxy with the classical break that we have been found at 23 magnitudes per square second, which is here connected with the decrease on the star formation on the galaxies. And then if we go down, we start observing another change around 27 magnitudes per square second, which is here, which is identified with the truncation of the galaxy. You will see later on this more clearly visible. And if we need to move of the order of 28, 29 magnitudes per square second to observe another bending and an extra light here that corresponds to this light here that we identify like the stellar halo. As I have said before, when one tries to make this kind of analysis, one needs to characterize not only the features connected to the observation, but also the scatter light from the nearby sources and the source itself. To do that, what you really need, as I said before, is to have an extreme and exquisite characterization of the point spread function of the images, okay? So that's what we did also with the GTC telescope. So we point to a very bright star, 2.3 magnitudes, and I think this was the only first time and probably the only ones that I have said to anyone that the GTC telescope was pointing to that particular region of the sky with no problem, because it's an absolutely bright star that you can see by eye. No? So we expand 10 meter telescope observing this bright star to get the point spread function of the GTC telescope up to 5 arc minutes with an exquisite signal to noise to reach a good characterization of the PSF. Once you have this, what you can do, as I said before, is to model all the bright sources around and make a scatter light map, subtract it, and have the influence of light around the galaxy clean, okay? and then you just leave the galaxy to study alone. But also you need to correct by the scatter light of the galaxy itself, because the galaxy is also emitting, it's also convolved with the point spread function, and many of the light from the center is contaminating the outer region. So you really need to deconvolve the galaxy. When you do that, look how the scenes change. So normally in the textbook, we have heard that the light of the central part of the galaxy, the light is decreased because of the effect of the PSF. So they say, normally you don't see all the flux because many of the photons of the center have moved around. But where was this photon? The photons were to contaminate the outer region. So look, the galaxy, when you take a look to the 25 magnitudes per square second, which is the traditional magnitude that has been used to measure the disk, you don't see any big difference between the two galaxies, the original and the PSF deconvolved galaxy. So we can be confident here that the 25 magnitudes per square second continues to be a good measurement of the size of the galaxy, okay? Nothing changes quite a lot. But if you look at 28 magnitudes per square second, look, if you were not making anything to the data but just exploring how the disks, let's say the thick disks around the galaxy looks like, you would claim there is a prominent thick disk around. But if you remove the effect of the PSF, look how the 28 magnitudes per square second continues resembling very nicely the disk shape. Now, the effect is also more dramatic if you go to 30 magnitudes per square second. Okay, so if you remove the effect, then all this huge circular light around disappears, and the external region becomes to be more filamentary, okay? As you would expect also from the cosmology. Of course, if you look at the superbrightness profile, the effect is quite remarkable. So this was the original profile, and this is the profile, how it looks when you deconvolve by the effect of the PSF, and look that beyond 26, 27 magnitudes per square second, and particularly if you move to 30 magnitudes per square second, the difference between the two superbrightness profiles is of the order of one magnitude. So it's a factor of three in terms of light. So if whatever statement that you were doing about the amount of light that is here, if you were not corrected by the PSF, would be wrong by a factor of three, okay? So this is how our galaxy looks in comparison at the same scale, 10 kiloparsec, 10 kiloparsec, than the deep data from the PANDAS survey of M31, and you can see that all the galaxies, these are similar galaxies, look quite similar when observed at the same level of superbrightness. The difference is that this galaxy can be studied because it's so nearby with the star counting, so just counting the stars. This would be absolutely impossible within the current telescope and also the telescope that you can imagine for the next year to do this kind of studies. So going very deep in imaging is really definitely something worth exploring to make a statistical comparison of galaxies outside our local group. And of course, you really then can estimate the amount of light that is in the stellar halo around the galaxies, and you can compare with the Milky Way M31. This is the galaxy stellar mass versus the stellar halo mass fraction. And you can see that this galaxy, UGC 180, it turns out to have of the order of 2% of the light in the stellar halo, okay, which is a few times 10 to the 9 solar masses. Very similar to the Milky Way and M31. In the future, we would like to fill this plane with many galaxies, so just to make a quantitative comparison with the prediction from the cosmology. So remember again, I'm emphasizing quite a lot this, but I think it's quite important, if the PSF were not accounted for, this galaxy would have three times more light here, and you would claim that the amount of mass in the stellar halo would be much more larger than what it really is. So the stellar halo is something to explore, and as I said before, the other kind of thing that you would like to explore is this type of galaxy that we know they should be there because it corresponds to the low superbrightness evolution of these ultra-diffuse galaxies. Once they become, instead of blue, they become much redder. So these objects should be around there, and they should be populating everywhere in the sky. Do we have any evidence of this kind? Well, as I said, there is one or two examples in Virgo, but there is also one example in the Stripe 82. So this is a Sloan, absolutely nothing here. And if you go to a Stripe, this is in a cluster region, you see something barely there, and if we push the data, we make smoothing and so forth, some blob, very big blob appear here with the superbrightness fainter than 27 magnitudes per square second. We have now a campaign with the GTC to observe this galaxy much more deeper, 10 times more deeper, in a number of filters, just to see what are the characteristics of these extremely faint, like two or three orders, much fainter than what these ultra-diffuse galaxies, okay? So I hope, just to finish, I hope I have convinced you that we are close, not only with this kind of work, but also with the ones that will come with the Synoptic Telescope, to discover a large number of objects that are still unknown. So I want to finish here with a very beautiful example of galactic cirrus that resemble a group of ghosts menacing our knowledge. And just to finish, my last slide is, I will be talking on Monday also at the Observatoire in Paris, on Monday at the 2:30? The Sala d'Atelier, of a different, completely different topic, but if you are interested, I encourage you to attend. In that occasion, on Monday, I'm going to talk about a new type of galaxies that are very rare and scarce, which are galaxies that are extremely massive and compact and has been found nearby, and it looks with exactly the similar properties that you can imagine than objects that were discovered at redshift 2. Okay, thank you very much.